Great. The unit number three is discussing the CLR and the SQL CLR and the PL, sorry, SP CLR. We are going to define actually a sort of user-defined procedures. We're going to deal with the scripting side of the TSQL. What we saw actually as enhancements in the unit number two is the SQL, the TSQL capabilities or TSQL potential, the rich experience that we may gain behind the use of the TSQL. We're going to explore in this unit number three, which is summarized in implementing stored procedures, or let's say stored procedures, actually the common language runtime procedures. Whether we are going to deal with the front-end technology to do so, or we are going to deal with the back-end technology to do so. Front-end, we talk about the APIs, SSMS or the SSDT or the Visual Studio, any other similar that you can use to connect to the back-end. Or we are going to deal with the back-end, which is mainly the SQL Server. Whether we're going to implement a thing from within the SQL Server or from within the API. In our case, we are going to define a user-defined procedure. Like we define the user-defined functions, unit number one, we are defined still the procedures. It's a functionality. We do not have to make a return through which, but it has to give an output, it has to give a result, a process. Let's dig in the context, the index of this unit. Briefly here, it is mainly discussing the use of the CLR, the server-side stored procedure. CLR, Common Language Runtime, it's a context of a procedure, it's a stored procedure. But to be implemented and to be deployed within the SQL Server, the back-end technology, CLR. We define what is CLR. It's a, use, is it a procedure, it's a stored procedure, but server-side. And what actually would be the stored procedure do? It would be actually interrogating the database. It would be interrogating the data entities inside the data store somehow for updates, for additions, for deletions, for whatever. Incrementally or actually decrementally viewed in action, those sort of procedures, they are seen actually to do increments or let's say whatever the management that you can think of, these sort of procedures or the CLR, they can help you in doing so. There are five actually basic entities that you can deal with within the SQL CLR. There are five main entities that you can deal with when implementing the CLR, the SQL CLR. The stored procedures, the sense of we are going to generate a front-end stored procedure that would interact with the back-end stored procedure from within the API, the SMS SSDT or the Visual Studio. You are going to generate a stored procedure that would interact with another stored procedure but created at the SQL Server, one inside the front-end, the API, and one in the back-end, the SQL Server means. And there would be actually an interaction. This is actually said CLR stored procedure, CLR SP. Is one of the, let's say, basic entities that we may deal with when implementing CLRs. Then the firing cause when the CLR would be executed. There are contexts of triggers that the SQL Server enhances, and those triggers, they are, let's say, procedures responsible for firing a CLR to be executed. When we say, for example, the time, to control the time to generate a clock, an autonomous clock, a schedule, we schedule a task to do within a time. This is a trigger. So SQL Server enhances triggers to be interacted with the CLR, and they are actually an entity that the CLR enhances. It understands. Also, predefined methods. mainly you talk functions. They are components that the CLI, that they are entities that the CLI can understand. Predefined methods or user defined methods. They are objects, entities that the CLI understands. We see those actually, those we see those entities in details just step by step. Good. Remember that our context mainly is the security perspective behind. If I come back to those entities, this is a good example. When you talk about a SQL CLI thought procedure, that it is an entity that CLI enhances. This is a good example of segregating, not aggregating, lacks. Segregating the controversy, segregating components related to one process amongst different physical parties, one inside the front end solution and one inside the back end solutions. And those two front end and back end solutions, they might be geographically too far, very far. Thus, this is a good example of security, physical security, even not only logical security. So technologies and techniques that they enhance the security that we would be deploying when talking about the SQL CLI, the CLI and the SQL CLI, diversity layering, encryption, secure coding, those are all techniques that would be actually implemented within our projects. We are not going to implement intentionally, but they are going to be deployed to finalize different tasks accordingly. The first security issue that we are going to see, behind of which we see the SQL CLI is a solution, is the injection. The very famous attack against databases is the SQL injection. It is not new to you, you know, what is it? So the vulnerability that we are facing here is the injection of, let's say, malicious script, injection of unwanted and undesirable and unpermitted queries, and the injection of any sort of heterogeneous component to the environment. I use the word heterogeneous, why? Because we might inject simple query like this one, simple query, just select something. But if you are not allowed to inject the SQL, you are allowed to write a username, for example, or a password, this is an injection, this is undesirable. It's not accepted to do so. Thus, this is the context of breach that we have to secure, that we have to find a solution for. Let's discuss the example we are seeing in front of us here to understand more the scenario of the injection or the SQL injection. We are having here three statements, three queries basically, query number one, query number two, and query number three. Three queries, they are interrogating the same entity. They are interrogating the same entity from within a database. The entity name is employees. We are interrogating the employees entities, entity singular, to display a value, which is the number of records inside this entity. How many employees are there in this company, or in a given company, or how many records are there in this entity employees? How many records? The first query, simply, there is a predefined method, which is the count. Just count everything inside the database. So he will give us a number, very easy. So these, the answer has, the request has been fulfilled. The second one we are utilizing, a specific let's say predefined, let's say method, I may say, and we are utilizing the nomination of table. Here we are given a variable name to indicate the entity, and here we are utilizing a variable also to indicate the count of rows. It's the same, select the count of employees, but we are utilizing variables from user tables, and user table and the table name is employees. We're close. I'm going slowly to bring your attention to make you understand, to focus with me. The third one is still the same, but it is most likely to be like the first one, except we are putting the entity in between two double quotations. So we have two queries with the same actually script, the first and the third. The first from the third, because of the quotations, the entity. The second, it differs from the first and the third due to the use of the variables. Which one would you use if I ask you to choose the most secure in terms of security now? Now, in terms of security, if you have any questions, you raise them now, because I went very slowly and now I'm gonna just clarify the context. The term of security here, you have to select one that avoids breaches or data, let's say, leakage. For our context, we are talking about the SQL injection as a problem, as a problematic view. He's discussing to us that there are actually they are accessing the same table, they are accessing the same entity, they are accessing the same entity. Yet, actually, some of them they are with quotations, other not. Single quotation here, double quotation here, no quotations here. The three types they are available. Which one is vulnerable? Immediately, the one with quotations is the one with actually the most actually vulnerable or risky to be actually attacked. Why? Because we know since the computer security, the tautology attack or the one equal to one attack. We know since the security, the tautology attack, the tautology attack. Or also we may call it, also we may call it one equals to one attack. This or that tautology attack or the one equal to one attack. What is this? This is actually a sort of writing script inside the text box in order to make you actually be able to inject whatever you want to make the system fail or to make the system grant you access and so on. Let me just give you the syntax of the tautology attack to make you understand more, to make you just refresh your mind. You see the page I'm in? In a text box or something like that, instead of writing your username and your password, you write the following. See this here, this script here, what I'm highlighting now. Instead of typing, for example, in the text box, your username, you type this one. What does it mean? Means that you are going to close a statement and to make the system decide either what comes before here in this left or one equal one. One equal one, is it false? No, it is true. It is usually true. It is usually true. Then all what it comes after is command. Minus minus in SQL, it's a command. Or what comes after, or even we can utilize this one, the slash star, the forward slash star. They are commands. All what it comes after, it's a command. Thus, the system will see this is wrong, and this is true, and he has a logical, let's say, comparison tool, which is the O. So he will say, he will take the true. He will open the system. Tautology attack. So this is done due to what? Due to the quotation. Quotation. Why? Because the user has implemented the query using a quotation, either the single or the double. They are valid, but they are most likely to be vulnerable. They are valid, but they are most likely to be vulnerable. Turn everything as it was. Great. So, as per an answer to the question, which one actually you would like to advise for to utilize to avoid the SQL injection of the data breach, is the first one. Is the first one. It's the first one. Actually, they are free actually to be utilized within a context, but you can secure all of them. All of them. We will see the role of the CLR and the SQL CLR. Just for now. Now this is actually only because of my instinct. I'm advising this first, but the three they are to be secured also. As per the first definition of the what is the CLR and what is the SQL CLR, it is a stored procedure that has to be actually interrogating the system for a reason or another. Actually, you are going to retrieve data, you're going to insert data, you're going to make updates, whatever you are willing to do. It is to interrogate the environment. It is to interrogate the environment. Those procedures, they are by default actually set to inactive. Means if you are willing to execute the SQL stored procedure, CLR stored procedure, the system will ask, will tell you actually access denied or you are not able to do. Why? Because they are not enabled. Thus, we need to enable the use of the CLR. Then after we do use the let's say we create the CLRs and we use them inside the system. So whenever you start a new project within the SQL Server, the CLRs, they have to be actually activated. They have to be enabled by just calling the predefined procedure, we see stored procedure configure, sp underscore configure. This is from the environment only, sp underscore configure. Predefined procedure. In between two single quotations, we say CLR enabled. CLR, it is recognized, it's also a keyword, enabled. We set the value to be one. See the syntax. The stored procedure name, sp underscore configure, space, in between double quotations, the CLR and the functionality is to enable. Then after comma, what is the value you need? To enable, put one. To disable, put zero. Confirm that. And let the system reconfigure himself. Let the system reconsider this query here. After sending this query to the environment, sp configure CLR enable one, you have to tell the system to reconfigure himself. Hey system, configure and consider the above statement. The above statement either to enable or to disable, both statuses. Means either you set it to be one or to set it to be zero. In all cases, the system has to reconfigure himself to consider this change. Any questions? Any questions, please? No questions. Okay, we continue. From the benefits that we may refer to the SQL CLR 4 is the use of assemblies, creation of assemblies and use of assemblies. What are the assemblies? The SQL CLR, they are actually an enhancement that the SQL Server gives in the sense of, if you are referring to the SQL Server, one of the functions that we give you is the TSQL, the functionalities, is the TSQL engine. And the TSQL enhances the creation of the CLR, the SQL CLR stored procedures. Okay, why should we refer to you? For what reason? For what functionality? Amongst the functionalities is to relate environment variables to the project. What does this mean? What is the environment we talk about? The environment is either the DBMS or the operating system where the DBMS is installed. I repeat, what is the environment that those CLR or stored procedures they are going to interact with? The environment is whether the DBMS or the operating system where the DBMS is installed. Means we're going to interrogate the DBMS, the engine itself, for specific values. Whatever, we can do that, but using what? Using the assemblies. Yet the assemblies, mainly they are to interrogate the operating system itself, the full, the external environment. The external environment means the operating system. Means from the SQL Server, we may send the queries to the operating system and vice versa. From the operating system, we may receive values to display or to just utilize from within the operating system. How this would happen? Using assemblies. What is the assembly now? The assembly, they are simple DLL files generated by the operating system, or just you may generate them you manually to utilize. And the example we're going to see today is an assembly that we're going to create manually. Yet, as a final stage, what is the assembly? It's a DLL file. It's a simple DLL file. Let's just go a step further. Let's just go a step further. See the example here. See this file here. What is this? SQL CLR demo.dll. This is a file. It's a DLL file. It's a DLL file. DLL file. This is the name, and that is the extension. DLL.dll. The DLL file. DLL stands for Data Linked Library. Data Linked Library. DLL stands for Data Linked Libraries. Those Data Linked Libraries, they are to define a library of data actually to be linked and to be utilized with an external environment or a different environment, whatever. Those are from the operating system, see the path, C drive. Those are from the operating system only. So, at the end of the day, just let me come back a step back. The assemblies, they are technologies also, but enhanced by the SQL CLR stored procedures, and they are generated by the environment or to interrogate the environment to be utilized from within the environment. What is the environment meant here? What is the environment that we are meaning here? The environment here is the operating system we talk. And mainly we talk about the Windows-based because the SQL Server is from Microsoft only, Microsoft environments. Exceptions are there, but this is the default value. Assemblies from the operating system, and the operating system is Microsoft based, and to, let's say, help the MS project environment or project, interrogate the environment, interrogate the operating system for different values requests to ask specific values from the operating system. So, integrating the assemblies and the most core functionality of the CLR actually is to integrate the assemblies for using functions, specific functions, dedicated functions, and specific data types. Within what? Within the attributes and objects that you may find inside the database. inside the project we talk, inside the project, from within the project itself. Roland's views, so whatever. Those are properties, attributes, and objects from within the project. So, conclusion here, the integration of assembly would help developers to utilize functions and types from within the environment when they define those objects. Let's visualize and let's see the example. Here in this example, we are visualizing a link to an assembly. And the assembly, as we said, as we define it, is a DLL file. It's a file that has the extension .dll. It has to be available in a system environment. So it's C drive here. So perfectly accepted. Second part. So here actually I create an assembly. This is from within the SQL Server level. Create assembly, given the name, it is user defined. This is user defined, means you can change, yes. From what? From this DLL file. From this DLL file. After loading the assembly, also, there is another stored procedure, but this is C sharp based. So this, as per our book, it's in C sharp, and this is clear from those curly braces. From within this actually C sharp block, we are using and we are calling two libraries, the SQL client and the server. The server to call those functions here, the SQL context, the pipe, and the execute and send. They are from the server. And to execute this new statement, new SQL command, it is the SQL client row. So to call, let's say, this method, the server library is responsible. To call the SQL command, the SQL client is responsible. Other than that, it's the body of the C sharp program. We have a class, and inside the class we have a procedure. It is return and void. This is a procedure, stored procedure. This block might be generated as stored procedure and saved where? At the front end solution or technology, which is either the SSMS or the SSDT or the Visual Studio or any similar. The load of the assembly would be done actually from within the SQL Server backend technology. This is the creation, yes. This is what we had to create. We loaded the assembly, and then after we generated a stored procedure. This is a stored procedure. It's a stored procedure, but it is actually server side. It can be CLR, common language runtime, because the SQL, the DLL file would be only executed at runtime. The DLL file would be executed at runtime only. So this is CLR, an example of CLR, and this is an example of a stored procedure. Working all together gives us the SQL CLR stored procedure. How to work that? How to make them work together? By just making the execution, no? So we are going to effectively call them and execute them from within the SQL, let's say SQL editor from within the SQL Server. What is the SQL editor? The place where we write the select, these insert, or the place where we write the SQL queries, where we write the SQL queries. So here we execute the stored procedure. The CLR, not the stored procedure, the CLR, the SQL CLR, because we are referring to the actually create procedure external name. We are utilizing the SQL CLR demo, which is actually defined earlier as the assembly name. And also we are calling the stored procedure. We are calling the stored procedure, the SP contains quick, which is the name of the procedure. The name of the procedure, here it is. What does this procedure do in this example? In this example, it only selects the totality of elements from the person table. Very easy. Select star from table. But to execute it, we call execute and send method, which is from the pipe from the and the pipe is from the SQL context. And all of them, they are from the SQL client library. So thus, here we call the CLR, and here we call the stored procedure. Any questions, please? Please, any questions here? So this is great. Okay, this is great. Since we don't have any questions, since we do not have any questions, let me pass just an activity. Let me discuss this activity with you, and I'll give you 1 minute to try. Otherwise, I'm going to solve it with you also. You are required here. We are required. It's an activity. You are required to create a stored procedure to display the table content, a database table content. Then load the respective assemblies. And also we are going to reload the respective assemblies as per the request. They are not mentioned. Database name is studies. Table name, SED profile. So starting with generating the stored procedure. Starting with generating the stored procedure to display the table content. What would be the solution? Any suggestions? Aya, any suggestions here, Aya? Okay, believe that you don't have any suggestions. It's very easy. It's very easy. We just call the library SQL client to pass the SQL command and the SQL server to make the to let's say to call the execute and send method. Then after we have this SQL context.py.execute send, the same command, but here select star from the table name, SED profile. He's saying the name here, SED profile is the same name, yes, SED profile. But here it is written to us dbo.sed profile. What is dbo? Stands for what? What is it? And it stands for what? Can you answer? Shall I mark you absent, all of you? نلف عليكم الكل absent, absent, absent. ايش رايكم؟ The DBO database owner, and it stands for it is the schema, but this table here belongs to. Good, this is the first part. The first part has been done. The second part, then load the respective assemblies, he's saying. The second part, load the respective assemblies, he's saying. Very easy. Create assembly, we give the name. It's the same process, no? It's the same process. So create. We say assembly, we give a name, and then after we specify the path. The path to what? To the DLL file. The path to the DLL file. Full stop. Full stop. The program has been actually terminated. We do not need to make any execution since it's not asking us. What is the okay? What is the okay? I'm gonna make the attendance, please.